Vandaag een bezoek aan het Holocaust Museum. En wel in Los Angeles. Daar in Californië hebben ze het wijs besluit genomen om dat niet alleen op de Holocaust en over de Holocaust te laten gaan. Maar ze noemen het het Museum of Tolerance. Het gaat over tolerantie. Natuurlijk gaat het ook over het verleden van de Joodse gemeenschap in Europa en over de hele wereld. Over de Holocaust, over de uitroeiing van 6 miljoen Joden. Maar dat wordt in een context geplaatst van deze tijd. En in Amerika betekent dat bijvoorbeeld in een context van de onderdrukking van de zwarten. Dat gebeurt in het Holocaust Museum in Los Angeles niet door de gebruikelijke manier van uitstalling van allerlei foto's en allerlei dingen, maar ze hebben er een heel multimedia gebeuren van gemaakt. Wat dat betreft is dit museum heel uniek. Ze gebruiken erg veel computers, beeldschermen, diaprojecties, geluidseffecten. En een van de manieren waarop ze de bezoeker, en dat zijn heel vaak schoolkinderen die in grote groepen langskomen, de manier waarop ze de bezoekers betrekken bij de hele problematiek is door ze, wanneer ze binnenkomen, de identiteit te geven van een van de Joodse kinderen die in de Tweede Wereldoorlog ten slachtoffer vielen aan de Holocaust. Je krijgt een kaartje en dat kaartje hoort dus bij een persoon. Je krijgt ook een mooie uitdraai en je volgt op je gang door het multimedia gedeelte van het museum. Een indringende manier om een koppeling te maken tussen de kinderen van nu en de kinderen van toen. En het draait dus allemaal om tolerantie. Om mensen erop te wijzen dat een gedrag wat voortvloeit uit racisme, antisemitisme, dat kan worden tegengegaan door tolerantie. En dat doet men door de bezoekers te wijzen op hun eigen vooringenomenheid. Zijn ze het type Joe Cool? Kijken ze neer op anderen? Denken ze dat ze normaal zijn en de rest niet normaal? De bezoekers worden geconfronteerd met zichzelf. Ze moeten kiezen. En ze worden vooral ook geconfronteerd met het verleden van Amerika. Wat ook niet helemaal brandschoon is wat betreft racisme, dat is duidelijk. En middels allerlei fotomontages wordt die geschiedenis van Amerika heel duidelijk in de context geplaatst van ook die Tweede Wereldoorlog. Zoals hier met Anne Frank. Ze hebben een dagboek van Anne Frank daar met wat versjes die we wel herkennen. Het Holocaust Museum, het Museum of Tolerance in Los Angeles, is dus niet alleen over de Tweede Wereldoorlog. Hoewel er een hele afdeling is waar je nog zeer indringend wordt geconfronteerd met de foto's en de overblijfselen. Maar het is ook over vandaag, over wat er nu in Amerika gebeurt. We gaan praten met Rabbi Abram Cooper, de man die als associate dean leiding geeft aan het museum. En onder andere betrokken is bij het opsporen van nog in Zwitserland berustende gelden van Joodse slachtoffers. We laten nog wat zien van de multimedia stukken van het museum. Waar men heel creatief met de techniek is omgegaan.
I mean, you gotta be smart or you wouldn't be at a museum in the first place, right?
Was there by mistake?
Now, do you already know that tolerance is how well we accept practices and beliefs which are different from our own?
What is this, Sunday school?
Of course, we do have limits, and we should. Why should we accept the lousy way certain groups drive, not to mention how the you-know-whos do business?
Don't get hippie and hassled by the homeless. Good job.
I'm sure some of them are homeless, but let's face it, you can tell which ones are just lazy, right?
Shapeless, lazy, thieving.
always living off our taxes.
We're always bragging about the fancy families.
Money.
You treat us.
Who cares if the chief or one leader over there was here first or foremost?
Los Angeles, California.
We all get it.
It's Nuestra Senora Reina de Los Angeles.
Got it.
Takes all kinds, I guess.
Ventura's chief loves to make waves. The people who run this place always making waves. Better to blend in. Like me.
Well, sure, why not?
The movement had a way of reaching inside me and bringing out things that I never knew were there. Courage.
That's what many people don't understand about what happened back in the deep south. That here I am. That this is my duty. I've got to do something. And God is with me.
Alles war uniformiert. So begann der Leidensweg der Juden, der in den Gaskammern der Konzentrationslager endete. Zeigte die Reichskristallnacht. Die furchtbare Saat des Rassenhasses ging auf. Boykott, Zerstörungen, Brandstiftungen.
You can hate or you can love. The museum to remember the Holocaust in Los Angeles is called the Tolerance Museum, which actually describes the mood that this museum is trying to bring over. We're talking with Abraham Cooper, Rabbi Abraham Cooper, who is the associate dean of not only of the museum but of the Simon Wiesenthal Center, which is the broader institution.
The Simon Wiesenthal Center was founded in 1977. It is the one of the largest now human rights agencies in the world, and named, of course, in honor of the great Simon Wiesenthal, who in New Year's Eve turned 88 years old. He's now spent more than half of his life as the famous Nazi hunter. We started as a small museum here in 1979. But when we asked Mr. Wiesenthal for his name, he said it came with a price tag. And the price tag, I'm sure that your viewers know, which is activism. He said that if we were only interested in creating an institution that would remember the past and have memorial programs, that this is very admirable. But to have his name, the price tag would be an institution that would be activist. And so from very modest beginnings, in 1977, a small museum of some 3,000 square feet in 1979, you've now visited our educational arm, which is the Beit HaShoah Museum of Tolerance, which has over 85,000 square feet of presentation space, high tech, and deals with many issues.
Rabbi, what is noticeable that it's not so much about the Jews, it's about racism and tolerance. And you have taken it into a far wider perspective.
Well, as you saw, the two main presentations on the main floor of the museum, the second half is a walk back in history, perhaps for some Europeans somewhat simplistic, but we sat down about a decade ago and asked ourselves some difficult questions. It's going to be the year 2000. Soon we won't have access to the generation of survivors and witnesses to those events. Are the lessons of the Nazi Holocaust going to be important to learn in the year 2000 and beyond? And if so, how do we impart those lessons? As a result of those discussions, and also seeing what was happening in our first museum, a very traditional, photos, captions. Young people were not reading the material. They would identify with the docent, a survivor would take them through, but no one would stay in a linear line in order to learn whatever lesson we thought. So our decisions were, number one, to utilize the latest technology to try to tell the story, which you have seen. But yep.
Which is basically you take the visitor first to something what you call today's activism, racism, prejudice. Right. You force them to kind of make choices for themselves. And only in the second half of the museum, and after passing to recent American history, Martin Luther King, the burning of churches was quite recently, you bring him to first the 20s and then the Nazi Holocaust during the World War II.
Exactly, because first, to complete the thought on teaching the Holocaust, we felt that we had a story to tell and that people needed to understand historically, geographically, just the facts of what transpired. Then once we have their interest, there's an entire floor with a huge database, a multimedia learning center that we're now transferring, by the way, to the internet for late 1997. But the idea is to empower the visitor, give them the information, let them make their appropriate decisions. But the other part of our discussion was a much more frank, maybe brutal question, which is, why should anyone, as we approach the year 2000, most of us born after World War II, why should we care? Why does it have any relevance to us? Why, especially for those of us here in North America, a continent removed even from the events, why is it important to study and learn the Holocaust? And for that, we felt that we needed to create a statement within our museum to empower each visitor on more basic issues of prejudice, tolerance, group prejudices, and what happens when people cross the line. The underpinning issues of personal responsibility, critical thinking, if you will, the 60s statement of challenging authority, not in a negative way, but questioning and ultimately taking responsibilities for one's own deeds. If we are able to empower the visitor on a level that they can relate to and have those basic, universal, difficult questions and issues already in their mind, then going back in history gives it a context. And from that context, you can then draw the necessary, we would hope, the necessary parallels. So it's important to understand that when people visit our museum, we didn't sit down one day and say, okay, we're going to spend over $50 million U.S. to create a human rights facility. What should we say? What you see next door is the result of 20 years of our institution being in the educational arena, a sense that we want to be true to the uniqueness of the Holocaust on the one hand, and also empower the visitor to be able to reflect in more universal lessons and personalized lessons to those issues.
Rabbi, as a European visitors, we went to the Holocaust section, and it looked like that's the stuff that every kid in Holland, at least that we know, learns in school. Yet you are bringing it here, and we saw a lot of kids in the museum. Is it because the American educational system does not give enough attention to the Holocaust and the whole history part there?
Well, certainly there are various states, including the state of California, New York, Illinois, Florida, big states that have mandated education on the Holocaust. But the funding for such education and the context for the education is often lacking. There is, of course, a general interest in World War II, in what happened with the Holocaust, the Nazis, etc. I think that the museum especially provides, however, a context, a setting, a basic understanding for why the Holocaust should be important. When I was growing up back in New York in the 50s, 60s, etc., the issue then, much closer to the event, was there weren't too many books. There were just a few films. The wound was quite raw. And also, for the vast majority walking the planet, whether in Holland or even on the streets of New York, you didn't have to explain the threat of fascism or what a swastika meant. Most people were involved somehow in this, swept up in the conflict, perhaps where they were in the military, maybe they lost a loved one, even in a battle, or perhaps in the Holocaust. So it was a different challenge and a different threat. Today, while it's true that I think most young people in Europe know the basic stories, it is also true that when you look now across Europe, whether on the streets of Moscow where you have Holocaust denial literature, or in your neighborhood, people like Le Pen and Haider and others, that fascism is pretty much back in vogue. And I think that, in part, those who want to promote certainly the most extremist elements of those programs know that in order to move forward with their concept, they have to whitewash the crimes of the past. So while it's true that the basic facts are known, certainly in a country like yours, I think it's always important to try to make sure that newer generations are given an opportunity to find an appropriate context. Otherwise, you can't learn these lessons by osmosis or just by saying it happened on this particular soil. Certainly, though, in the United States, which is removed now by a generation and by an ocean to the events, it is the initial presentation quite basic, and we leave the more scholarly and in-depth material for the computer learning center, where one can spend 15 minutes or 15 days for that matter. The idea here is to lay out the basic story, explain in human dimensions what transpired, and I think you probably saw in the museum that we try to use technology to personalize and humanize. I think Stalin was the one who said that one death is a tragedy and a million deaths a statistic. And what we try to do is to fight the battle against that kind of apathy and the glazing over of all of these figures by both providing the figures and the actual facts, but giving it a human dimension.
Do you see the visitors recognizing the link, the parallel between what happened here in Los Angeles a few years ago and what happened in Germany?
Well, I don't know that you can say there's a direct line that you can draw, but I think by the time people walk out of the museum, they're going to reflect back on what they experienced. I think in terms of Los Angeles riots, the interactive presentation that's there, the most important element, and you know, it's in a rather loud environment, and you would think young people spend a lot of time at those stations. I think the main reason is that we ask them what they think. One of the biggest challenges for parents, I'm one, I have three daughters of my own, also many educational systems, we teach a lot to our children, a lot of information. We don't often ask how they feel. And in this particular presentation, we ask the museum goer, what do you think you would have done in this kind of situation? And we let them know what the previous visitors had said to the issue. I think one of the strengths of the museum is a message to young people. I want to emphasize it's not a museum for children, but for young adults, and that is that we care what they think, and that there is a sense of trust, that we're basically saying we trust you, that you have the potential to make a kind of ethical and moral decision. And even if they're not being totally honest with themselves when they're answering those questions, I think what's most important is that people walk out of the museum with a question. Remember, you entered the museum, there were two doors. One, right, was with marked with prejudice, and one marked without prejudice. We've had presidents. We had the chief rabbi of Israel, who's a survivor of the Holocaust, Rabbi Lau. We had His Holiness the Dalai Lama. We had King Hussein of Jordan. All come to the museum, every single person who comes to the museum. First, we hope they're not arrogant enough to try the door that says they're prejudice-free. As you know, it's locked. And everyone must go through the door that's marked with prejudice. That is probably our only overt philosophical statement to everyone coming through. There are no saints. Let's start with the reality, hold up a mirror to our prejudices, and what are we going to do about it? Excuse me.
Rabbi, the museum is very much a technology feast. If it weren't so tragic, you would think it's a very good demonstration of new technology. Is this intentional?
We don't apologize for the fact that I think we have demonstrated that you can put the cutting edge of technology in service of human rights. We're very proud of the fact.
This is LA, and this is the reality too.
Yeah, we're very proud of the fact that museumologists and educators from all over the globe, I was recently in South Africa, people involved in thinking of what kind of museum in honor of Mandela, yes, you can learn from here that technology can be put in service of human rights. That's a plus, and we should basically not worship technology and not throw up our hands and say, let the technology run our lives, but technology can be put into service for not only to sell cosmetics or some other service, but also in the name of human rights.
If you compare this to the place in near Jerusalem, it's also called the Holocaust Museum, or
Yad
the show?
Yad Vashem.
That is much more a memorial place than this. Is that intentional?
Well, what's interesting is that Yad Vashem, the new director, has been to our museum on four occasions, and the next generation of Israelis have to make very difficult choices about how to memorialize, and certainly to understand that for the newer generations, you do have to use the technologies in order to transmit. But remember, when we're talking about whether it's in Holland, or if we're talking about the State of Israel that was born out of the ashes of the Holocaust, and you're in Jerusalem, you have, in that sense, a kind of context and head start that will never exist in a place like Southern California. So we have a memorial plaza. We certainly have programs here in memory of the victims of the Holocaust in appropriate times throughout the year. But our emphasis is education.
Your museum is slowly becoming a virtual museum too, in the sense that you are putting material on the internet and people can find it under what site name?
Well, right now we have a web page that has both the Wiesenthal Center's issues and a very brief introduction to the museum. Very simplistic, because of people like me who are not so adept, it's just www.wiesenthal, which is wiesenthal.com. And you can go from there. Later in, we anticipate in the fall of 1997, a very significant educational tool for people all over the world, including in Holland, will be a internet version of the Multimedia Learning Center on the Holocaust. And that's very exciting. That'll have its own web address. And for people who will just go to our original page, we'll let them know where to go. But clearly, the internet is a very important, dynamic, cheap new technology. And right now, we average about 1,500 visitors a day from all over the world on our website.
Now, cyberspace is the new frontier, but also the place where old things like racism and anti-Semitism pop up again.
Right now, we are monitoring close to 400 problematic web pages. That's double of just a few months ago. And for sure, it will increase, because this is a kind of gift across the board, where suddenly, if you want to target a certain kind of audience, youth, if you want to present your materials in an unassailable way, web page, like a free-floating advertisement, in a technology that to date has been difficult to get a handle on, it's understandable that anarchists and bigots and racists and anti-Semites and Holocaust deniers will rush to embrace this technology. The single biggest problem that I believe that the internet has right now is that there's no librarian. There's no critical thinking available on the internet. So if we would step away from our issue of hate or the Holocaust, go to something much more basic. Let's say if you have a young person doing a research project on astronomy, they may choose the information on a web page from the Flat Earth Society, find it more believable, more usable, because of all of the wonderful bells and whistles, than, let's say, a scholarly essay by a Carl Sagan or a great scientist, you know, based in Europe. So I think one of the great challenges ahead for this dynamic, wonderful new technology, if they really do want to become the most important gatekeeper of communications and ideas, is the need to promote and to reflect some sort of critical thinking. Right now, it all has a particular limited moral plane, and that's a great challenge to us all.